Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Moshe Vardy. I'm going to read his short biographical sketch. He is the George Distinguished Service Professor in Computational Engineering and the director of the Ken Kennedy Institute for Information Technology Institute at Rice University. He is a co-recipient of 3 IBM Outstanding Innovation Awards, the ACM SIGAT Girdle Prize, the ACM Canalacus Award, the ACM SIGMOD COD Award, the Blaise Pascal Medal, the IEEE Computer Society Good Award, the EATCS Distinguished Achievement Award, and the Southeastern Universities Research Association's Distinguished Scientist Award. He is the author and co-author of over 400 papers, as well as 2 books, Reasoning About Knowledge and Finite Model Theory and Its Applications. He is a fellow of ACM, AAAS, IEEE. He is a member of the U.S. National Academy of Engineering, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the European Academy of Science, and Academia Europea. He holds honorary doctorates from the Sorbonne University in Germany and Orleans University in France. And as everyone knows, he is the editor-in-chief of the CACM. So first of all, I want to say that he is obviously a very distinguished scholar and academic and so on. But even with all these surface activities, what impresses me so much about Moshe, he is still so active in his research. And I'm so envious of this because, for instance, I was on the LICS program committee this year and I saw all these submissions by Moshe Vardy. And these are deep papers. And then when I was preparing my CAV keynote, I actually had to cite so many of Moshe's recent papers because of his continued contributions to logic and semantics of programming languages. So I'm really impressed by Moshe, his ability to keep up with research despite this enormous service contributions to the field. And then I just want to emphasize, you know, he has in the little blurb, he is the editor-in-chief of CACM. I think that the young people in this audience have no idea of what that really means, because even before I was a graduate student, CACM was the premier journal in ACM. All the really famous seminal papers were published in CACM. And then there was this period of time
The dark ages.
I think it was the Lipton-DeMille-Perlis paper, actually, that started it. And people actually stopped their membership to ACM, because I thought, why get CACM? It wasn't worth reading. And Moshe, I really attribute, single-handedly turned that journal around, turned the prestige of CACM around, so now everyone looks forward to their monthly issue of CACM. So we really owe Moshe that. But today he's going to talk to us about logic.
Thank you for this almost embarrassing introduction. It reminds me of a story about 3 MIT students who submitted a paper, and each one has a footnote next to his name. The first one wrote a footnote, AT&T fellow. There was a fellowship from AT&T. And the second one had a footnote. It says Hertz fellow, because he has a Hertz fellowship. And the third one wrote, a jolly good fellow. And Moshe Vardy single-handedly, together with about 100 other people, revamped CACM, and one of them was Janet, of course. So I want to talk about a logical revolution. And I'll try to maybe summarize this first on one slide. Okay? During the past 50 years, there have been extensive continuous and growing interaction between logic and computer science. In many respects, logic provides computer science with both a unifying foundational framework and a tool for modeling computational systems. In fact, logic has been called the calculus of computer science. The argument is that logic plays a fundamental role in computer science, similar to that played by calculus in the physical sciences and traditional engineering disciplines. Indeed, logic plays an important role in the era of computer science, as disparate as machine architecture, computer-aided design, programming languages, databases, AI, algorithm, and computability and complexity. This is really the summary, in some sense, what I will say in the next hour. But this is in fact somewhat surprising. There will be such a connection. Why should there be a connection between an obscure old intellectual discipline, going back 2,500 years, and a very young intellectual discipline? Martin Davis, in a 1988 paper where he wrote about the subject, wrote, "When I was a student, even the topologist regarded mathematical logician as living in outer space." Today, the connection between logic and computers are a matter of engineering practice at every level of computer organization. And this was in 1988. And partly what I would try to answer in this talk is, why on earth did this connection been successful? But partly, we'll have to go back and to explain where logic comes from and where modern logic or mathematical logic comes from. And in some sense, you can say that this goes back to the late in the 19th century, when people started to try to formally reflect on the methodology of the sciences. And so you can think, OK, what is the basic method? What is physical science? The life science is only now, in some sense, trying to reach the same level of maturity, going beyond just the lab. But in the physical science, we have a very clear model, right? You build a mathematical model of reality, you analyze that mathematical model, you end up with some predictions on how the world ought to behave, and then you contrast it with the physical reality, okay? And of course, this is a bit of a caricature, it's a reality, it doesn't happen so neatly, but that's the essence of it. And this raises the questions, okay, what is a mathematical model? And so these questions, which is mathematics starting to reflect on itself, is really something that only has starting to happen late in the 19th century, when people start trying to take the tools of mathematics and point them at mathematics itself, self-reflection. And probably you can attribute it to the first important step in this direction is Friedrich Ludwig Gottlob Frege, published in 1879, a small book called Begriffsschrift, which is a language for concept. And he is asking, what is the language of mathematics? And he's trying to found mathematics on basis of logic. This has become known as logicism. And the logic that emerges from this, and I say emerges because these concepts were not clear at the time. It took maybe 50 years before this became clear. But essentially, you can say that as a logic, he developed first order logic. And by that means that he realized that every mathematical discourse is about basic objects, maybe numbers, predicates and operations on them, relations between them, maybe less than, and operations such as plus. Boolean operations were studied a few years earlier, studied by Boole, and or not, implies. And the quantifier introduced by Peirce a few years earlier, for all there exist. So this is the basic elements of every mathematical language, so to speak. And we can go back and say Aristotle was talking about all men are the syllogism, all men are mortal. We can be more precise, and it says for all x, if x is a man, then x is mortal. And now we have, no, this doesn't have a pointer. Now we have, we use a logical language. We use the inverted A to say for all. So this says for all x, man of x means x is a man. Arrow means imply, and mortal of x means x is mortal. Okay, so now we have a language. We can formalize all the syllogisms. But more important comes out of it that we also get, and this takes a while before this happens, it happened in the 20th century, we get a definition of what is a mathematical model, what is a mathematical structure. And so at that point, there are many, many mathematical structures. There are graphs, partial orders, groups, ring, fields, metric spaces, what have you. But the observation is they all have the same format. They all look the same. They have some domain, a collection of relations over these domains, and relation is a set of tuples of some arity, and a set of functions over these domains. Okay? This is a mathematical model, a domain, relations, and functions. Okay? And example, what is a graph? A graph is a set of nodes and a set of edges. And so the nodes are the domain. The edges is the edges of a graph. This is a binary relation. And now we can take the language of first order logic and we can talk about graphs. We can say for all x, this y such as r of xy, this says that every node has an outgoing edge. Okay? So now we have a language to talk about graphs. Or if you want to talk about groups, group we have a set of elements and one binary operation, the product operation, and we can say for all x and y, and there exists y, such that x, y equal y times x. So this is a commutative group. So now we take this standard definition of on one hand, a mathematical structure, and a standard language over that structure, and we can describe mathematical properties of structures. So I will focus mostly on graphs as the kind of as the running example. So let's dig a little deeper. What happens when you have first order logic on graphs? Your variable ranges over nodes, and the atomic formula are either saying there is an edge from x to y, or x equality of x to y. And now you compose sentences using from atomic formulas, using Boolean connectives, and the quantifiers. And I'll show two examples. I want to say the node x has at least two distinct neighbors. So I will say there exist y and z such that not y equals z, so y and z must be distinct. And e of xy means there's an edge from x to y, and e of xz, there's an edge from x to z. So x has two distinct neighbors. Now in this one, I'm talking about some x, and what we say is x is free in this formula. I haven't told you that who that x is. It's just a generic, at this point, it's a generic variable. Now I want to say every node, or each node has at least two distinct neighbors. Now, I would say for all x, there exists y and z, such that y is distinct from z, and are edges from x to y and x to z. Okay? Now, this, the second one, does not have any free variable. We call it a sentence. And either true, it's true in the graph or not true in the graph. Either it's true in this graph, every node has two distinct neighbors or not, and we write it with this double term style. G, we say G satisfies phi. The graph has this property. This is a property of graphs. And the first sentence is a property of a particular element, x, and we have not yet said what x is. Now, in 1902, Frege received a letter from Bertrand Russell, a young philosopher from the UK. And the letter cites very, very nicely. Frege reads the letter and he's very pleased. Russell writes, "I find myself in agreement with you in all essential. Funny your discussion, distinction, and definition that one seeks in vain in the work of other logicians. There is just one point where I've countered a difficulty." Okay? This minor difficulty was so severe that when Frege's book, next book, came out in 1903, in the appendix he adds, "There is nothing worse that can happen to a scientist than to have the foundation collapse just as the work is finished. I've been placed in this position by a letter from Mr. Bertrand Russell." So this, of course, became famous as Russell's paradox. And essentially what Russell found was a contradiction in Frege's book. So Frege had a beautiful system, only little problem, it was inconsistent. So that led to the so-called foundational crisis in mathematics. Okay? People dug into that period into the foundation of mathematics only to discover the foundations are in contradiction. So all of mathematics, you have a beautiful edifice, but it stands on chicken feet. So into this crisis steps David Hilbert, who is the foremost mathematician around the turn of the century, and he wants to fix this problem. He wants to solve the problem once and for all, and he wants to do it by formalizing mathematics and proving that it is consistent. Consistent means there's no contradiction. You cannot prove something and its negation. It is complete. You can answer all mathematical questions mathematically. And even more, and this is in some sense the beginning of computer science, it is decidable. You can do this mechanically. There is a decision procedure for every mathematical statement telling you is it true or false. Very, very ambitious. In fact, it was so ambitious that he was doomed And he was doomed fairly fast. It didn't take very long. We're starting in the 1920s, and by the 30s, it's all crushed. It's crushed by on one hand, Gödel. The first two decisive blows are by Gödel, who proved that mathematics is incomplete. You cannot answer all mathematical questions mathematically, and you cannot even prove the consistency of mathematics mathematically. And this, of course, the Gödelian sentence saying, I am not provable. And this leads you to, if you assume it's provable, you run into a contradiction, and its negation is not provable either. And then a few years later, using, again, diagonalization technique, self-referential technique, Church and Turing prove that first-order logic is undecidable. You cannot decide the truth of mathematical statements algorithmically. Yeah, so the first result of computer science is a negative result. And this problem, the so-called decision problem, was floating around for years, but was posed in a very sharp way by Hilbert and Ackermann in their 1928 book, which was the first book on mathematical logic, modern book on mathematical logic. They call it Entscheidungsproblem, that's in German, the decision problem. And independently, Church and Turing, Church a little bit before Turing, but independently, proved it's unsolvable. And of course, Turing, we know now, after last year was the centenary of Turing's centenary, he defined Turing machine to define what does it mean to be computable. And again, using diagonalization, proved that termination is undecidable. So again, you construct a machine that terminates if and only if it doesn't terminate. And then you reduce it to the decision problem. So that means if we look at where logic stands in 1936, in some sense you can say this is the foundation of mathematics. It's incomplete. It cannot prove its inconsistency. It has unsolvable decision problem. The most fundamental computational model is itself already undecidable. What happened? We have a bunch of negative results. So there is some attempt to see, can we still get something? And mathematicians do, if the general problem is hard, let's specialize, let's look at special cases. So there's some attempt to look at special cases. And one project was the classification project. Yuri was involved in that. I'm going to simplify and not give you all the gory detail, but it was a long project. It almost took 70 years from the beginning to the end, roughly from 1915 to 1983. It's a long time. And essentially, at the end, we found there are some small number of classes that are decidable. So let me jump ahead a little bit. The monadic class, what is the monadic class? It's first order logic, but your predicates, your relations are monadic. They are one place, no binary predicates. Now today this looks like a very, very weak logic, but all the syllogisms are all about mortal, Greek, they're all monadic predicate. So in monadic logic you can say something such as if for all x p of x, and if for all x p of x implies q of x, then it must follow that for all x, q of x. And already in 1915, Leopold Löwenheim proved that this is decidable. And the techniques that he used are a very important technique. One is called the bounded model property. Prove that if a sentence is satisfiable, has a model, the model cannot be too large relative to the sentence. So if you're given a sentence, it has, you know, its length, you can enumerate all model of that size and check whether it's a model, all structure of that size. And you do it by, you prove the bounded model property by quantifier elimination. The thing that makes first order logic expressive, the quantifier, if you get rid of them, you're basically back to propositional logic. So this is one class, monadic logic. It's a fairly weak class. The other classes are so-called prefix classes. It depends on the structure of the quantifier. So the Bernays-Schenfingen class exists, a bunch of exists, followed by strings of for alls. And Ackermann means that you can have alternation, but you can only have one universal quantifier there. And Gödel says you can have, Gödel class, you can have two universal quantifiers, but then you better not have equality, because just adding quality already makes it undecidable. So these are all actually very, very weak classes. There isn't really, there are very, very few applications where you can do something using these fragments. Very, very few. They're just generally simply too weak. So you can say instead, well, maybe this is too generic. Yes, you had a question there?
Propositional set is a subset.
We will get to propositional set. Okay? Hold your thought. So one idea was let's look at maybe some, instead of being so generic, just looking at quantifier and syntax, let's try to look at some semantic, some semantical domain. How about addition, integer addition? What can be a simpler theory, integer addition, where you have the natural numbers, you have equality, and you have, let's say, one operation, the plus. So you can go ahead with this, and you can start defining multiplication by constant to say that y equal 2x, you write y equal x plus x. You can say that x is 0, because x is 0, it means that for all y, either y equal x or y is greater than x. They tell you that x is 0. And you can say that x is greater than y because there is some element z that is not 0, and y equal y plus z, and so on and so forth. And then essentially you discover very quickly you can define integer programming and more. So this is clearly a non-trivial theory. You can definitely say important things in this theory. So in 1929, Moises Pressburger, Moises is Moshe, so this is my namesake, he axiomatized integer addition, sound and complete axiomatization, and he proved that this is a decidable theory. Okay? And he proves it essentially, again, by quantifier elimination. If you eliminate quantifier, you end up with integer addition plus congruences, reasoning about congruences. And he shows this is decidable. Today we have also automata theoretic techniques which perhaps are simpler to prove the decidability. So this is a beautiful result. Until we start looking at the complexity. Only in the 70s we looked at the complexity, and we have a triply exponential upper bound, and we have a doubly exponential lower bound. So after this result, in 1974, Michael Rabin had a paper in IFIPS. There used to be IFIP conferences. Some of you may remember, there used to be such conferences. So Michael Rabin has a paper, Theoretical Impediment to Artificial Intelligence, and he says the complexity results point to a need for careful examination of the goals and methods in AI. This is a very polite way of telling AI, get the hell out of here. Will never happen. Even something as simple as reasoning about integer addition is completely infeasible. That's essentially when you read between the line, what he's saying, it's a pipe dream, cannot happen. So let's talk about, another positive result that people were able to get, another very nice positive result. And this is reasoning about something very simple, about words. What can be simple reasoning about finite words? So let me remind you all a little bit of automata theory. Okay? So this is a very basic object that we get in any course on automata theory. You have the model of NFA, non-deterministic finite automata. And an automaton is you have a finite alphabet, finite set of states, set of initial states, a non-deterministic transition function. So given rho takes you from S, a state and a letter, to a set of possible successor states. That's a non-determinism, a set of possible successor states and a set of accepting states. And what you do is now you feed it a finite word. An automaton runs, and a run is just a sequence of states. And you start in some initial states. And each time you look at transition function, it gives you a set of possible successor states. You just select one. And the important thing you do, you have to be smart about the selection, so the final state has to be an accepting state. Okay? And here is a little automaton. You can see here that when you enter on the left, and you can see the zero always will take you back to the left, and one always take you back to the right. And the red circle means you accept on the right. So you can see that you must accept on the right, therefore the last letter must be one. So this is a very simple automaton. Define all the words that end with one. And as we know, NFA defined a class of regular languages. It's a very robust class, very rich theory, very nice behavior. So these are NFA. Now, in the late 50s, people realized that a finite word is a mathematical structure. It's a particular type of mathematical structure. Okay, remember, what is a mathematical structure? Domains, relations. Okay, what is domain here? Well, the domain is a set of points, right? It's an n position. Every position is element of the domain. We'll use one predicate, binary predicate, or dyadic predicate, to say which position comes to the left of which position. So it's a less n position. And we're using monadic predicates to tell you what letter is written in every position. So that means that you can now use first-order logic, even second-order logic, to talk about words. by using atomic predicates. And even, I won't talk at length, but you can use even set quantifier to quantify over sets of positions. So let's look at this sentence. What does it say? It says there exists an x, such as for all y not x less than y. So this says there exists an x that no y is bigger than x. That means x must be the last position. And p sub 1 of x. That means the last position is 1. So this is very similar to what I just said in this example. So we saw that the property, the last position in 1, you can express it using an automaton, or you can express it using logic. And in 1957-8, three people independently, Bushy and Elgott in the United States, and Trachtenbrod in the Soviet Union, proved that these two languages have the same expressive power. And they defined this class of regular languages, and in fact, they gave us, the proof gave us an effective translation in each direction. There is a little piece of history that I'm missing here. Bushy and Elgott wrote one abstract followed by two different papers. So there must be something juicy here. But do you know, happen to know what happened there?
I don't know, but I know Bushy. He was a very difficult man.
Wrote an abstract. They had to agree on so many words, and after that, they would not collaborate more. It must have been a hard collaboration.
Were they working on the results?
No, no, they announced this result in one abstract. So originally, there was one abstract announcing this result. And it used to be then, in the notices, you publish abstracts to claim priority on the result. And would follow, the paper would come later. This was like the conference that we do today. They would just publish an abstract to announce the result. Now, this is, of course, a beautiful result on one hand, but it's not. It's a very useful result. What makes it useful? So I want to, let's talk about the so-called non-emptiness problem. Given an automaton, does it accept any word? So given an NFA, is there any word accepted? Is the language non-empty? So it's a very easy problem, because if you think about it, it just means there must be a way to go from an initial state to an accepting state. There must be some way to do that. So we abstract and we said, let's take the graph of the automaton to consist of all the nodes are the states, and there is an edge from S to T, if it's possible to make a transition from S to T reading any letter. So it's the graph. So essentially, it is correspond to going here, erasing all the labels in your left with the graph. And now it's an easy lemma. You can take it, you can give it to undergraduate students to prove that the automaton is not empty if and only if there is a path in the graph from initial to final state. And this is now clear, we can solve it by any kind of graph reachability algorithm. Easy problem. Now, what's the analogous problem for logic? The analogous problem for logic is, given a sentence, does it have a model? Is there any word that satisfies this sentence? Now, this is a first order sentence, a second order sentence. Not clear how you even approach it. How do you decide whether a given sentence is satisfiable? Well, the translation tells us very easily. It says that phi is satisfiable if and only if the automaton is non-empty, because the automaton and the sentence have the same set of models. And we know how to solve emptiness of an automata. So we have an algorithm. The algorithm means first translate from logic to automata and then run your graph reachability algorithm. Very simple algorithm. Except that when we go to the complexity analysis, we discover that the translation, which is very simple translation, is done by induction. And every step in induction may involve one exponential, but it's an induction. So you get a stack of exponential whose height is itself linear. Now you could say, well, this is a simple algorithm. Just go back, think of a more clever algorithm, right? There must be a better algorithm. Well, by 1974, we know there isn't one, because Larry Stockmeyer proved that even for first-order logic, there's already no bounded height tower of exponential. Now, in case you have never saw this tower of exponential, let's do a real calculation here, very quickly. Okay? 2 to the 2, 4, no problem. Okay, so far, so good. 2 to the 2 to the 3, 256, manageable. 2 to the 2, 2 to the 4, about 4 billion. Okay, that's not start to be demanding, but still doable. 2 to the 5 is roughly 10 to the billion, okay? 10 to the billion is not an astronomical number. It's a cosmological number, okay? It's more than, if you take the whole known universe, like, I don't know, 14 billion years across, and you pack it with, what is it, the Planck constants, which is 10 to the minus 35 meter, okay? Pack it densely. You don't get that many things. So this is a very large number. Now somebody said, well, propositional logic is a special case of all this logic. So let's go back to propositional logic. Let's go back to the middle of the 19th century. And we find George Boole with a beautiful idea that you can go back to all the syllogism and think of them in algebraic fashion. So this is, 19th century is a century of algebra. Everything become algebraic. And Boole realized logic can be treated algebraically. And he writes, if an adjective as good is employed as a term of description, let us represent by a letter as Y all things to which the description good is applicable, i.e. all good things, or the class of good things. Let it further be agreed that by combination X times Y, here I'm using the algebraic convention, the juxtaposition means multiplication, X times Y shall be represented, the class of things to which the name or description represented by X and Y are simultaneously applicable. That, thus, if X alone stands for white things and Y for sheep, let X, Y stands for Y sheep. So Boole says conjunction is Boolean multiplication. Okay? So this is the big insight to think of logic as an algebraic operation, in this case, multiplication. And out of this, we got what we call now SAT, the Boolean satisfiability. You're given a Boolean expression using AND, OR, and NOT. And you want to know, can you satisfy this? Is there an assignment of zeros and ones to the variable such that the whole expression gets the value 1? So here is an expression. It's called in conjunction normal form. It's a conjunction of disjunction. And in this case, there is indeed, if you didn't solve it very quickly in your head, I'm going to tell you that this particular assignment will make it 1. Now, already in the 19th century, people realize these are difficult problems to solve. So William Stanley Givens, a British logician and an economist, already wrote, I have given much attention, therefore, to lessening both the manual and mental labor of the process. The process is this kind of Boolean reasoning. I shall describe several devices which may be adopted for saving trouble and risk of mistake. So he built the first logical computer. It has a nice shape of a piano. It became known as logical piano. Ernest Schroeder, who lives a little later, right, an amazing sentence to me. Getting a handle on the consequences of any premises, or at least the fastest method for obtaining these consequences, seems to be to one of the noblest, if not the ultimate goal, of mathematics and logic. Just to solve this logical reasoning problem. And there was a huge project in the Soviet Union in the 50s and early 60s, described very nicely by Trachtenbrod in an article in Annals of the History of Computing, to solve generally this class of search problems. Okay? This was the Parabor project. And it ended in the early 70s when Cook and Levy independently proved the Boolean satisfiability is NP complete, and therefore we don't think there is some clever way to somehow solve the problem. Yeah?
Parabor. Both A should be E.
Both A should be E.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Parabor. I always think, however, what does it mean when the language is such a short word for such hard work? What does it tell you about the language and the culture? Yeah. Thank you. So, of course, you know, this is, many of you here probably know it. This gave us the class of so-called the phenomenon of NP completeness. NP is a class of problems where we can check solution quickly. We can check very quickly if a graph has a Hamiltonian cycle. If somebody gives us a candidate cycle, I can check whether it visits every node exactly once. I can check, somebody give me a factorization of a number, I can check it very quickly that it's a right factorization by multiplying, but finding solution is hard. And there are tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of problems that are in NP where we can check solutions easily, but finding solution is hard. And NP complete are the hardest problem in NP, and it means if you solve one NP complete problem in polynomial time, you can solve all of them in polynomial time. So this is an amazing phenomenon. And therefore this has become one of the most outstanding problems in computer science. And one of the things when we relaunched CSEM, I went to Lance Fortnum and I said, why don't you write a survey article on P versus NP? And he said, what's there to write? All I can write is, still open. Do you accept short articles? I said, yes, but please elaborate. So he wrote an article about it. And we realized there's some strange activity on the website. And the article, after within like 3 months downloaded, we had about 50,000 downloads. And it was so interesting that this article on completely theoretical subject, just saying the problem is still open, getting so many downloads, that we got an article in New York Times just on the social phenomenon. Okay? There's nothing new to report. There's no scientific news. Okay? There's no scientific, but we got a New York Times article. So Scott Aronson, I thought, said he always, he writes beautifully, he wrote, if P equal NP, then the world would be profoundly different place than we usually assume it to be. There would be no special value in creative leaps, no fundamental gap between solving a problem and recognizing the solution once it is found. Everyone who could appreciate a symphony would be Mozart. Everyone who could follow a step-by-step argument would be Gauss. So the common belief is that Boolean SAT cannot be solved in polynomial time. And then, in fact, Janet gave me gave a lead to it. You know, logic became one of the first big projects in computer science. If you go and open StockFox, the primary theoretical computer science conferences during the 60s and 70s, and you will see that a major topic was how to prove correctness of programs. Okay? So this was a dream that was launched by Tony Ho, one can say, in 1969, when he wrote that the correctness of a program, its compiler, and the hardware of the computer have all been established with a mathematical certainty, it will be possible to place great reliance on the result of the program. And I said this was a huge thrust of theoretical computer science. And then in 1979, we had an article in CSEM and by DeMillo, Lipton, and Perlis, and they wrote, we believe that program verification is bound to fail. We cannot see how it's going to be able to affect anyone's confidence about programs. Very unambiguous language, okay? And their argument was that the acceptance of a mathematical proof is a social process. People read the proof, they become convinced, they tell their friends, they discuss it, and this referee, there is a process. And they argue that computer proof will go through the social process, so the proofs are useless. That's what their argument in a nutshell. So this is our, roughly, if you look at logic, where it's in 1980, 1980 is important here because I became a PhD student. So here is where logic is. It is undecidable. The decidable fragments are too weak or too intractable. Even Boolean logic is already beyond our ability to do anything. Programification is hopeless. So what can you say about it? Not a very promising career, so to speak, if you're going to focus on logic in computer science.
Just the naivete of youth, right? What can I say?
And what I want to show you in the next, in the rest of the talk, is how things have changed, how this is what I call logical revolution. And I will try to talk about the successes. And of course, this is just a sample. I'm sure I'm missing a lot, so I'm probably missing things that are people who are right here in the room. So please bear with me. It's just a small sample that we can cover in 20 minutes to give you a sense of how things have changed. I'll talk about databases, relational databases, Boolean reasoning, model checking, and termination checking. And I swear that I prepared this talk even before I was invited here. So I will talk about Microsoft research, but it's not because I'm trying to suck up here. This talk, I've prepared it before.
Fuzzy logic.
I will not talk about fuzzy logic. I will not talk about fuzzy logic. So in essence, the putting 1980 is a pivotal year is a simplification, because I think things start turning already in the 70s. I mean, history is always messier. And to me, the first turning point was the relational databases. And this is where we went from model theory to relational theory. And so in classical mathematical logic, a sentence that has no free variable, either true or false in a graph. And therefore, it describes a set of models. The set of models of this graph are all the graphs that satisfy this sentence. So model theory is the theory that talks about classes of structures described by logical sentences. That's what model theory is. Now, model theory is interested again in structure described by sentences. Formulas are a bit of a nuisance because they have three variables, so they're not talking about anything specific. You have not yet told us what they're talking about. But Ted could realize, in fact, if you look at some textbooks in logic, you realize that formulas are this nuisance you have to go on the way to the real thing, which are sentences, which have no free variables. When I was taught logic, this was formula were just necessary building blocks. But Ted Codd in 1970, or 71 maybe for this, realizes that formulas are important because formulas define queries. Okay? So if we go back to this sentence, to this formula, where x was free, right? There exists x and y and z such that they are distinct and x has two distinct neighbors. Now you can think of it as a query. Give me all the nodes that have two distinct neighbors. So for every formula, I can now think of a formula with k3 variables, and I can apply to a graph, and I say, give me all the bindings to the variables that will make the formula true. Okay, so you need the concept of a binding of a free variable. And this gives rise to relational databases in SQL. SQL by now is a over $3 billion industry. Microsoft has significant presence there. And this was actually one of the fastest turnaround between paper and Turing Award. I think he received a Turing Award before Cook, for example, received a Turing Award for NP completeness. Yeah?
So relational algebra was discovered by Tarski.
Right. And Codd
in the quarter of century.
Right. Codd knew nothing about it.
Right.
Codd knew nothing about it.
So the real significance of Codd is the application to database.
Right. You can say that he has done nothing of importance. No, there were actually many people. There were many people when they read the first paper, the conceptual paper, looked at this and said, what is this? This is total non. There were people really who just completely dismissed. This was a CSEM paper. And there were many people who read the paper and said, there's content free. People described the first paper, really it's content free. It's amazing. Yeah. So Codd had two important ideas. One is, and again, they are in some sense trivial observations. One is the tables are relations. Tables, which is people use, I don't know exactly when people start using tables, as a way to describe data. And Codd realized that this corresponds to the mathematical concept of relation. And of course, any mathematician would say, of course, but Codd was the one who did it. And the second one, that formulas are queries. There was another thing which he argued, that by using algebraic treatment, you can compile them into algebraic expressions. And again, he reinvented essentially cylindrical algebras.
Right.
I'll mention this in a minute. Thank you. Good point. Anyway, it was a project that started roughly in parallel at IBM, San Jose, and Berkeley, and Oracle was the company to come ahead and kind of run behind around everybody and start. In fact, the company was first called Relational Software and later renamed themselves after database. And then actually that forced IBM development unit didn't want to do this. They had another product. But Oracle essentially forced their hand to get into this business. And so really the insight was, people say, wait a minute, you just told us that first order logic is undecidable. But there are really two distinct problems. One is the truth evaluation problem. I give you a formula and a graph and a binding. Tell me if the formula is now true. And the graph is finite, of course. The other one is, given a sentence, a formula, is there a graph and binding satisfied? And satisfiability is undecidable, but checking a formula is just, you know, it's just a one big nested loop. Go over all x, go over all y, just try all assignments, see if it's true or not. I mean, this is not very efficient, but in principle, it's decidable. So this distinction is very, very important between satisfiability and evaluating truth in a given finite structure. Now, I talk about SAT, and people start dealing with that almost from the very, very early computers. Already Newell, Shaw, and Simon in 1955 built a tool called Logical Theorist, and they were able to prove all the theorems about propositional logic in Principia Mathematica, and they were very proud. They wrote a letter to Russell telling him, we're able to prove mechanically all of your theorems. And then who started the study of SAT?
of course, NSA. This was recently disclosed by Snowden, of course. So the first work on modern work on SAT is Davis and Putnam in an unpublished technical report of the NSA. And there was a sequence of papers. And by the early 60s, there was a standard method. It's called DPLL, which is basically you convert the formula to conjugate normal form, and you do a backtracking search. And there is only really essentially one heuristic. If you have a unit clause, if you have a conjunction that just say P or not P, then use it. Give it preference to anything that has no ambiguity. Use it as soon as possible. And there was a small community who has been working on it for many, many years, making very, very, very small progress between the 60s and almost for 30 years. I would say very minimal progress has been made on it. And, however, from the roughly mid-90s, we had really essentially a revolution. And today, this new body of techniques, all based on DPLL, but it was a whole bunch of heuristic, called CDCL, conflict-driven closed learning, many more heuristic, back jumping, that is, don't just do backtracking, go one level at a time, but go back fast, if you can go back faster. Be smart about how you manage these units, close preference, smart data structures. Whenever a branch of the search fails, draw a conclusion from your failure. Make sure you don't repeat the same failure again by learning new clauses. Be smart about how you branch. So it turns out, this is a very important principle in computer science, is it better to be smart or fast? Because to be smart costs time. And very often, the answer is, don't be too smart. Don't be too smart for your own good, but be very fast. And the heuristic today make a very careful balancing between being smart and being fast. And restart, that is, if you're not going anywhere after a while, just give up. Go back to the beginning, re-randomize, and restart. A whole bunch of heuristics. Two very important tools in the mid-90s, GRASP from Michigan, and SHAF from Princeton in 2001. And today, we solve problems with millions of variables. I mean, to me, this is just, you know, when I was a graduate student, NP Complete was, stay away from it, you know? Even looking at the problem was dangerous. And today, we solve problems with millions of variables. This is just, to me, a stunning development. Now, here is a slide. It was developed by Sanjit Sesha from Berkeley. And what he did, he took a bunch of tools and ran them. He has a more recent one. This was in 2007. He ran it on a 2007 machine. So this is all on the same machine, same benchmark, same machine, just the tools between 2000 and 2007. And you can see how we have three orders of magnitude improvement over less than 10 years. This has become known as the Moore's law. For SAT solvers, an amazing phenomenon.
Can I speak a question?
Yes.
So for historical reasons, we concentrated on SAT.
Right.
And there was this wonderful progress.
Yeah.
Now, we could have concentrated on something else, for example, integer programming.
Yeah.
And then it would be triumph not of logic, but of arithmetic.
Well, you know, history is capricious.
Right.
But it's not so clear. I mean, there are areas where we have concentrated. There are areas where people have worked for a long time, you know, really closed fields, which is logic. But people have worked it for a long time, and progress is slow. QBF is, I mean, there are some successes. I'm trying to focus on the successes. There are many bodies along the way. Yeah.
But arguably, integer programming could have worked even better.
So actually, there have been some attempts. In fact, some of us have tried. I tried at some point. Because next to me there are people who develop just down the hall. People who develop Cplex, and they say, "Oh, integer programming." And so the answer is there is something about actually the simplicity of SAT. The fact that it is so simple makes it easier to experiment, to develop simpler data structures, to the turning around of heuristics and time, because this is what we have now is just amazing sweet spots of kind of crowdsourcing for heuristic and finding which one works. And, you know, is it just historical coincidence or is there something deeper? You know what Cho and Lai was once asked about the French Revolution. What do you think about the French Revolution? He said, too early to tell. So maybe you're right, but you know, we'll come to me, come back with these questions in 50 years and discuss it. And the nice thing about SAT is over the last few years, and much of this work has been done here, it's not just about just a purely mathematical question. I think what's really, I love the work being done here is how people have found so many different applications for this in real life software engineering, okay? So this has become, it's not just a theoretical work anymore, it's really become part of simply software engineering. And finally, I'll give one example which is related to the issue of the talk. We talk about MSO. I'll talk about this. And this is again reasoning about program, but in particular, in the mid 70s, Amir Pnoili realizes that we're interested, there are many, many classes of program. In fact, even by the 70s, most programs are not programs, they just have input and output. But they're like, you know, what is the output, input of this machine? Everything is about interaction. So Amir Pnoili realizes already in the mid 70s, you must reason about interaction and not about input output. And he needed logic for interaction. So he was hunting around and he found a philosophical logic called temporal logic, which was the and for which he received for this the Turing Award, which was just the right logic for talking about interaction. So he proposed temporal logic to talk about ongoing behavior. And he, even the first paper, he already says, it's decidable. You can reduce it to another second order logic. No problem. It's non-elementary. He was really not too concerned about it, fortunately for us. Okay? And fortunately, the program committee did not reject the paper. They're saying because it's non-elementary. And so I'll just give you some example, just the flavor of temporal logic. This is not to talk about temporal logic, but you can say things such as mutual exclusion, always not CS1 and CS2, I mean process 1 in critical section, process 2 in the critical section. Always request implied eventually grant. Always request implied request must stay on until the grant is given. And all kind of very, very useful properties when you want to reason about ongoing behavior of programs. And again, Amir Pnoili was more interested in the mathematical theory, in the logic of systems. But a few years later, people start thinking, can we do it algorithmically? And there were two important papers about algorithmic verification by Clark and Emerson and Kay and Sifakis. And they talk about a somewhat related logic called CTL. And they prove that if you have a program whose state space is M and you have a formula of size N, you can do the checking in times N times N. Now, there was some of a dispute between the CTL people and the LTL people. So Pnoili replied a couple of years later with his student, and he said, OK, if you use LTL, even though originally I told you you can do it in non-elementary time by reduction to MSO, there is another way to do it. And now you're only paying exponential price in the formula. So it's linear in the size of the program and exponential in the formula. But now you cannot use automata. Now you have to use a set of heuristics called tableau, which I won't get into. But if you use this heuristic, then you can do it in exponential time instead of non-elementary time, which is, of course, a huge improvement. But it almost seems like that if you want to use automata, you're doomed to have to do it in non-elementary. But it turned out that you can use automata. And the idea is you have to don't go to MSO. So Pierre Wolper and I looked at it in the early 80s. And we realized that if you focus on translating LTL formulas to automata, but don't translate to MSO, find a direct translation, then there is a direct translation which is exponential. So going from LTL to automata can be done in exponential blowup. And this is what I call the exponential compilation theorem. And this is enough to give you really all the result that you want to have. The L satisfiability, for example, is in P space. It follows from this that LTL model checking is in exponential time. It follows from this. And today, it is in widespread industrial usage, not so much in using LTL itself, but in using industrial languages such as PSL, property specification language, and SVA, which is system variable assertions. These are all industrial standards that have been derived from LTL, and the implementation is based on using this automata theoretic approach. And we can even go back to the very beginning. Remember, we started almost the second bad news was Church and Turing. First order logic is undecidable because termination is undecidable. And then in 2011, Cook, Podelsky and Rabalchenko, Byron Cook from Cambridge, Microsoft Cambridge, wrote, in contrast to popular belief, proving termination is not always impossible. This is, I guess, a British way of saying this. Or not always impossible. Or maybe diagonalization. The reality is the terminator can prove termination or divergence of many, many Microsoft programs. And many, many programs. Of course, not all of them. The first question people ask, what happens if you apply terminator to itself? And of course, the answer in this case, it will not terminate. Okay? So there is some, to me, there is some very important insight here. Why is it that on one hand we can prove the problem is unsolvable, undecidable, but in practice it doesn't seem to be hard? And the reality is, if you ever wrote a program, and probably everybody here wrote a program, if your program terminated or didn't terminate, did not depend on the extended Riemann hypothesis. If it terminated for very simple reasons, and if it did not terminate, it was also for very, very simple reasons. And therefore, for example, if, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the 3x plus 1 function. Okay? If you take us, and then we don't know whether it terminates or not, right? But if you give terminate, terminator is not going to solve this problem. But most of the termination problems are very easy problems, and terminator solves them fairly easily. So this brings us to the end of the talk. I think what I wanted to show that we went from logic from around 1980, like seems like a total failure, to today. It's an area where it's many successes, many challenges, many areas we have not made enough progress, but they're even more exciting in some sense. And there is some, I think, important difference as opposed to, I think, the early period. Much more focus on algorithms, not just on reasoning, but on mechanical reasoning, on reading on algorithms. Heuristics are incredibly important. We don't understand them, theoreticians hate them, but the success of SAT is due to just a bag of heuristics that nobody really fully understands why they're so successful, but they're very successful. Lots of experimentations, lots of experimentation. I mean, again, the way we discover SAT is by just crowdsourcing the problem, running in parallel many, many heuristics and looking at all this combination, finding the sweet spots. Lots of tools, lots of systems. And I think there is even more fundamentally, when I was a graduate student, worst case complexity ruled the day. I mean, we were taught, okay, prove this algorithm is, if you prove that one algorithm is quadratic and one is linear or n log n, surely the n log n algorithm is better, right? Worst case complexity. And today it's much more, I think, complicated picture. All I can say about worst complexity, it barks, but it doesn't necessarily bite. And I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Well, we have plenty of time for questions. Ken?
So you haven't mentioned some other applications of logic and computer science, for example, logic programming. Is that a success or a failure, or is it even logic?
Too early to tell. So, I would say is that, you know, many years ago, I had a project when I was a research manager in industry, we had a review of some project. And the manager in review says, what I'm hearing here is a lot of hope. And I said, all of research is about hope. So the answer is that reality is most of what we're going to do in our life, it's going to be forgotten, right? This is it. Most of research is failure. John Backus has written, I don't know if anybody saw, he wrote a beautiful piece about it. He says, we don't publish the failures, but we publish the successes. So people get distorted picture about research. Most of research is failure. This is true everywhere, it's true here, it's true everybody does research. Now along the way, sometimes because we're all human beings and we have to be funded, there are lots of hype that comes along the way. And some of it, you know, this we discover later, it didn't pan out. There are many directions don't pan out. So I think logic programming is a panacea. This is the way, in fact, anybody who promises you a panacea, you should be skeptic by now, right? So logic programming is a panacea was a failure. Actually, there is one, to me, area that have come out of it that I'm moderately impressed, and this is called logic answer set programming. And this is a way to solve optimization problem using a version of logic programming. You combine it with many of the heuristics today of SAT. Actually, you combine it with such engines, and you get actually, it's a fairly nice language to describe optimization problems and use a solver underneath to find a solution.
So I'm sure that people in that area, they can say more. Clearly you don't deliver. Remember, the fifth generation, Japan is going to rise. We might as well, this country might as well retire because of logic programming. That didn't happen. Yeah.
I'll make a comment. So a few years ago, I gave a somewhat similar talk at the University of Chicago about the importance of logic. The idea was to teach logic. But my stress was in a different place. It is that engineers, right here at Microsoft, badly need logic and don't know it. So they don't know how to explain themselves. You speak to a very bright guy, you explain him something, and he says, you think that, oh, I now understand. You say that this language is a subset of that language, which can mean so many different things. They don't have the vocabulary to speak about things they badly need. So everybody write languages of different kinds here, and the logic in education is ubiquitous. So for example, they all studied calculus, never use it, they never studied logic, and use it all the time. So that was my stress there, that do teach logic. So this is one part. Second, let me, concerning, as a logician, I'm happy to hear what you said, but a little skepticism. For example, Immerman once solved the problem, used logic and make a big deal out of it. And the Slovakian fellow, Sheriff Cheney, solved it without knowing any logic. Also, Cook, I spoke to Cook how he can. So he came from logic. He just looked what happens in the recursion theory and tried to do the same here. Now, Levin came, it's a completely different angle. So the whole thing came from electrical engineering. That's where the reward exhaustive inevitability of exhaustive search came, but nobody can prove it. And so he found a way to make, nobody could even formulate what does it mean that it's not inevitable. It is inevitable, right? And he found a way to formulate it. So in his eyes, it was about, it's more about electrical engineering at the time.
So I read Levin's paper. Calling electrical engineering is a bit of a stretch. It's a bit of a stretch. Beautiful paper. I mean, he does Cook and Karp in about three pages. It's pretty amazing.
No, whole paper, page and a half.
So it's pretty amazing. But I wouldn't call it. It's not necessarily kind of declarative logic, but it's very much about Turing machine. So it is definitely logic. Look, I mean, as I said before, along every research area, there is some hype along the way. I mean, there have been many attempts in complexity theory to try to bring some other, you know, we are so stuck there. We think, you know, the latest thing is what's going to be is algebraic geometry will save us, right? People always think, if we just bring some other mathematical domain into this. So far, we have been humbled every time. People thought there would be proof complexity, it will be discrete complexity, circuit complexity, and all I can say is, the German phrase, Mensch planen, Gott lachen. Man plans, God laughs. So the complexity theory gods are just laughing at us about every attempt, including logic. So, in fact, but even Immerman, when I don't think there, people say, oh, this was logic. It was a combinatorial argument. I never bought, even his own paper made a combinatorial argument. So when people say, yes, but I thought about using logic, I was never there. So in fact, if you look at the sub complexity, probably it's fair to say in particular area that complexity helped logic more than the other way around. Because we can do separation results in logic using complexity theory, not the other way around. So, you know, there's some failure along the way. This is the way life is.
Education.
So I would actually broaden this because I think we have a problem. We have a problem is that we have 4 years for a bachelor degree. That's it. Nobody, you know, in fact, if at all people want to make it shorter, faster, right? It's expensive. Everybody's talking about cost reduction. And we have a growing discipline. So you want to say, well, now we need to have distributed programming and web programming and search and data mining. And so the thing that's very easy to get squeezed are the theory courses. And it doesn't matter even if it's logic or discrete math or automata theory. Okay? And people say, well, where do we have people are going to use, you know, this automata theory? So I'm not even talking about that, as we saw, it does have application. What we're losing there, we're educating a generation of computer scientists who simply don't know how at all how to abstract, because they have lost, you know, this generation still had to carry the old work, okay? But we have a generation of people, they just cannot reason abstractly. And if anything we do know about complexity, which is what we're dealing with, whether it's software or hardware or system, the only way we can think about complexity is via abstraction. And now my worry is that we are losing the ability of people, because then that's what you learn to me from all these courses in math. You learn to abstract. And by cutting, and adding more and more courses on this topic and that topic, that's my big worry. Logic is, losing logic is part of it, but I worry in a bigger way, but losing the ability to abstract.
So I also have a comment and a question. And it's sort of triggered by Yuri's comment. It's not just developers that don't understand that they need logic and vocabulary. It triggered the thought that back in CACM, Vince Cerf had an article in the October issue that was calling for more of a science of the understanding of programs. And I thought that the article was somewhat surprising and even stunning for its complete absence of any acknowledgement of the existence of logic and of logic in computer science. And so it's a comment. I'm not expecting a response from that. But
we review all articles going to CSM, except for the columns by the president of CSM. That's all I can say is matter of editorial policy.
But on a related note, I was at an NSF workshop where Pamela Zabe was talking about the state of network protocol documentation. And the IETF still likes ASCII, and they still like tables, and they use ASCII art for drawing state machines, right? And that's like still, right? So it's like, there's also sort of, I mean, we're still working on getting, you know, getting languages and formalisms adopted by other disciplines who are just, you know, in our industry, just running ahead to finding the new protocols.
Right. So in this regard, just to close the thought from Yuri's comment, I would assert Microsoft is actually the most enlightened in this respect in the industry. Right?
Well, I would let me go further. So in 2008, when Clark, Emerson and Sifakis received the Turing Award for model checking, and somebody sent me an email pointing to a blog by someone from Google or Yahoo, a respectable theoretician, kind of member of the Stock Fox community, who wrote, they got Turing Award for model checking? How can, I'm rephrasing, I'm not 100%, how can someone receive a Turing Award for something I never heard anything about? Okay? It was the claim was, look, if something is that important, I should have heard about it somehow, one way or another, a hallway conversation, talk here. I need to have heard about it. And so on one hand, you know, logic is declining in education. At the same time, that I think what Microsoft Research has done is show how important it is for the practice of software development, right? So formal method is flourishing much more in Europe than it is in the US. And this is a time where actually, you know, we want to know if something is important. One way to look is look at what happened in industry. And in fact, what was shown here is how useful it can be to software development. So I have a hard time myself reconciling this this paradox. Yeah.
The question is on the idea of proof as a social process, you know, that Lipton, Perlis mentioned, the systems and tools that we have today, they do internally try to prove things.
Yeah, I think that was a, there was they showed that they thought that it's going to be hand proofs. I mean, they were so blind. They thought it's going to be hand proofs of correctness. And of course, we know that we already know by then that this the proofs are humongous, that are not going to be scalable. Already by then, people were working on mechanization of this. And they could have said, you know, they could have said the same thing. They said, hand proofs are doomed. The challenge has to be fully mechanizing these proofs, okay? If they have said that, it would have been, I think I would have agreed with them. But they stopped after one half, and there was, and in fact, it was irony, right? Because the model checking paper came up within 2 years. And they completely missed that idea that you can mechanize the proof.
So you characterized SAD as being, I think it was a pile of heuristics, and we don't know why it works. And I hope that's,
do you know?
I hope that's not entirely true. But the thing had, the phrase had a ring to it, a pile of heuristics, and we don't know why it works. Because I think that characterizes almost every large software system. So if that's true, you know, how do we get from that situation to a place where we can reason, logically about a system?
So I think that, to me, I view the success of SAT as a, also a great challenge and opportunity. Because I go to theoretician and I say, look, it's an NP-complete problem. We all know we can generate problem with hundreds of variables, and no SAT solver can handle them, right? And then the same SAT solver goes around and solves a problem with millions of variables. What does complexity theory have to say about that? It just talks about the worst of complexity. It gives us no guidance. What problems are hard? What problems are easy? So right now, I would say is, I'm hoping there is some beautiful theory that's yet to be discovered that explains. Okay, so this is a begging for more theory to understand it. But this is true in general. When you have something very complicated, you know, sometimes we understand it, and it takes a long time maybe. Right now, I think that we've had empirical, it's like having, we are a little bit like physics was in the turn of the century. We heard a lot of experiment, but nobody could explain what the hell was going on. And to me, that's what's happening now. We have experimental evidence that this works, that this is very easy. Well, I don't think we have a good theory. I mean, not that I've seen.
Right, but perhaps you could characterize Windows as an empirical success. Right, most of the time it doesn't crash.
I don't think it's a fair analogy. I mean, here we have a mathematical problem, and we have not a proof, but a lot of evidence that this is a hard problem, but we cannot explain when it is hard, when it is not hard. So. In particular, for example, one of the ways that Windows does work is a lot of decomposition and orthogonality and separation of concerns. And I don't think you can say that about SAT. It's just this particular combination of heuristic. It's just try this, no, doesn't work. Okay, try this, shift it here, do it here. Maybe I'm too pessimistic on this, but to me, it's a sweet spot that emerged experimentally, and I don't view it quite. It's not, you know, people did try to apply in principle some software engineering principle to develop Windows. And I don't think the situation is similar. There are some SAT experts here. They can talk about it more than I can talk about it. Yeah.
So I think we can make huge progress on average case complexity and things like that. But typical case, probably it's very hard to analyze because it involves human psychology. But a simple example is typing. So typing is P-space complete. Typical programs are very easy to type. Why? Because when I write, I need to make sure that at least I understand what I'm talking about. And that soft side of things is difficult to analyze.
Yeah, but I could imagine that there is somebody would come up with some metric for SAT problems, something you can measure, something syntactical that you can measure. And it will somehow be predictable whether a SAT solver will spend a lot of time on it or not. It's imaginable to me that happens, okay? I mean, right now we don't have anything like that. I mean, another example that people struggled for many years is to understand why we're so successful in linear programming. Okay? Linear programming was an example, right? What is it? Klee and Minty in 1974, I believe, if I'm correct, you know, proved that simplex is exponential. And then in practice it works incredibly well. And people actually have tried average case complexity. And that was not a good explanation. But we finally have an explanation called smooth complexity by Spielman. And that's a much more satisfying explanation. You read this and you say, okay. And I actually thought, gee, I'd love to apply to something other than linear programming. It's very hard. It seems to be very specific to class of problems around linear programming. But, you know, it took us a long time to find some mathematical explanation why something works so well. So I think I'm hoping that something will emerge for that eventually. It will explain and what is special about the problem we're looking at. Why is it we cannot break RSA using SAT, but we can solve huge circuit with SAT? I think eventually we'll figure it out, but it may take some time.
Another area where I find this is true in computer science right now is in machine learning. There are a lot of algorithms and there are a lot of data sets for which certain heuristics of parameter set works really well and others doesn't, and we don't really understand why. So this may very well be just a phase in our field where we're, you know, the paradigm right now is scale, millions of variables, you know, terabytes of data, whatever it is, and then the algorithmic complexity people will catch up to figuring out why it all works.
Look, it's a social phenomenon, in my opinion, because somehow this kind of problem have not yet caught up with. We have a theory community of utterly. You go to Stock Fox, and you are at all at the brilliance, mathematical brilliance of people there, but they are not looking at these kind of problems for somehow. And when you tell them, it's messy. We don't. These are real problems. We don't want to look at real problems. Okay? It's hard to convince them to look at this problem. And I would say, if you look now, so one of the reasons I think that we made such progress in SAT is because of the competitions. Competition has been very, very productive. People really want to compete. They want to win. They publish what wins, and the whole field progress because of the competition. But the competition are an hindrance to deep reflection about why things work. Because I had a student, and I wanted the student to spend more time to go into the deep why, what's happening. And he told me, but I will never win the competition with such a paper. So we finally found a way how to win some competition, okay, by doing something. But competitions are a two-edged sword. So they help us on one hand to move faster. But there is a guy where is he? I think he's at CMU, Hooker. He's at Industrial Engineering or something like that, John Hooker, I think, at CMU. And he wrote actually a paper years ago, Algorithm versus Heuristic, we got it all wrong. And we said we're focusing so much on just improving runtime. We're not spending time to try to to understand how the algorithm works internally. It's a very hard work, very experimental work. Try to figure out what's happening, why does it work so fast? And our community somehow at this point does not appreciate it. So people go where the community wants them to go, which is go faster, young men, go faster. Okay, thank you very much.